afternoon, everyone. Welcome to FOSSASIA. And this is Hao Yi.
Hello.
He used to be at Dropbox, and now he works for Fluent. And he is going to tell us how to beat your JVM into submission.
Okay, hello.
Carry on.
So this talk is going to be about taming a Java virtual machine. About myself, previously I was at Dropbox Engineering in San Francisco. Currently I'm working on a startup, Fluent Technologies. So we build Fluent, which is the world's fastest online code browser. So if any of you are working on like a project using GitHub and are sick of clicking through a GitHub UI because of how slow it is, then you should check out fluentcode.com and see if this is of interest to you. And I've done a lot of work in various programming languages. Currently, Fluent runs on the JVM like many other systems do. And so this talk is going to be about how to understand what's going on inside the Java virtual machine. So when most people learn how to program in Java, who here has used Java before? So most of you have used Java to some extent. So you start off writing some code like this. It runs, you define some variables, some are primitives, some are objects. In the end, they look kind of the same and you can do things to them. But this code, although it does what you'd expect, leaves open a lot of questions. For example, there are things like the memory usage of these things that you're defining. Nothing is for free and each of these things costs you something. What happens if you run out? There's a garbage collector. What does that mean to you concretely? And here we say we system the order print line S plus 123. But what's actually happening there? It's not just trivially adding a string and an integer. There's actually a bunch of code underneath that makes it all work. And where does JIT compilation come in? So a lot of this is traditionally brushed off when you're learning Java as implementation defined. But in practice, everyone here is probably using the same implementation. And most people use Oracle or OpenJDK, and not that many people use some of the alternative JVMs like IBM J9 or one of those. So although this implementation defined, if you're working with implementation, we want to understand what your JVM implementation is doing, what it's doing with regard to memory use, what it's doing with regard to JIT compilation, what it's doing when it's actually running the system, the out.print line. And so in this talk, we'll cover a few things. One is memory usage of things within the JVM, one is garbage collection, and the last is how the compilation really works. So to start off is memory layouts. So having garbage collected memory is great if you have enough of it, in that you can just run your code, write whatever you want, and the stuff you don't need just get cleared up in the background automatically. And it's terrible when you don't have enough of it, because you write your code and things blow up. It says out of memory exception, blah blah blah, program cannot run. And you're not sure why it's giving you out of memory. It's not so easy to say, oh, I allocated this much memory here, that much memory there, and I didn't free it. Because when you're writing Java, you don't keep track often. You often do not keep track of where memory is being allocated and how much. And again, although it's technically implementation defined, everyone's using the same implementation, so we can dig into that. So over here, let's make this bigger so people can see it. Big. Let's see. Memory. Let's scroll here. Still not very clear. So over here I have a small demo of a tiny Java program that you can kind of use to see how much memory things use. The key is this runtime.getRuntime.TotalMemory and runtime.getRuntime.FullMemory, get free memory. So this lets you see how much is the total memory of your entire JVM, and how much of it is free, and therefore by subtracting them, you can find how much of it is used. And by subtracting that each time that we call this method, we can see what's the change in memory usage after we perform some operation. So for example, over here, I'm defining an array of integers with length count. I'm just going to set it to 10 million for now, just so it's big and easy to see the effect. And I'm going to fill them with a bunch of length two integer arrays. and then I'll see how much memory is being used. So over here, if I go back to my shell, come on, memory. I'm just gonna run this from the command line so I can easily tiddle with the flags. Come on. So I compile it, I run it, and in the end it prints out 28. And what's the units of 28? 28 says that the increase in memory divided by the total number of items is 28 bytes. So there are count items, I'm dividing by count. So each of these size 2 int arrays takes up 28 bytes of memory. And that's interesting in that we can see how the effect changes as we change the number. So for example, if you make them size 0 int arrays, it takes up 20 bytes. If we make them size 1 int arrays, takes up 28 bytes, and size, for example, 3, takes up 36 bytes. So here we can see something's interesting, because integers are, by what we know, should be 4 bytes large, in that there are negative 2 billion and positive 2 billion. But here we can see that the size of the array is actually rounded to the nearest 8 bytes, or on 64-bit. Computer like this Mac, it's a so-called normal word. It's like a word. So we can repeat this operation for many other things. You can make a long array, a double array, array of objects of various size. And what you'd find is, where's my slides? Here it is. And what you'd find is, for the primitives, they more or less behave as you'd expect. Booleans are surprisingly 1 byte large. Maybe not surprisingly, but not obviously, they're not a single bit. So if you want to something that can store many booleans, you need to explicitly use a bit set rather than just an array of booleans. Bytes are 1 byte, shorts are 2, ints and floats are 4, longs and doubles are 8. That's to be expected. If you repeat it with the Java boxed primitive types, that then it gets a bit more interesting. So booleans and bytes, java.lang.boolean and java.lang.byte are both 4 bytes large. That's because each of those is a wrapped object. So, and in by default, the object pointers are 4 bytes large, even on a 64-bit JVM, on a 64-bit operating system. For the rest of them, you get 4 bytes plus the data that's actually being used to store the value. So for example, for shorts, it's 4 bytes for the pointer to the java.lang.short object, plus 16 bytes for the actual object, because the object has an object header, it has the ID of the class of the object, and then it has the data of what's the short value rounded up to the nearest 8 bytes. So turns out like java.lang.short, java.lang.int, or integer actually, Even though shorts are small integers, they both take up the same number of bytes once they're boxed. And longs and doubles correspondingly also take up more than that. And if you start looking at arbitrary objects, you'll see that arrays take up 4 bytes for the pointer to the array, followed by 16 bytes, followed by 16 byte header, and then whatever data that the array actually takes. So each array has and each object is a 4 bytes for pointer plus a 12 byte header plus whatever data it takes rounded to the nearest 8. So this is this may seem a bit obscure, but this actually matters, because if you are looking at, for example, comparing an array of ints to a Java lang of integer, you're looking at a 5 times increase in memory usage if you do not use a primitive int array versus using, say, a java.util.list or java.util.vector. And a 5 time memory usage is the same, is the difference between a $10 EC Amazon instance and a $50 a month Amazon instance in terms of memory. So concretely, there are many things you can do to reduce memory usage. in any application, there are a lot of high-level changes you can use to put things on disk, put things in database, put things in memcache, whatever. But even within your code, very simple things like using arrays or primitives instead of using box Java util collections. And if you need something that's a bit fancier than an array, for example, you need a map which has tons of primitives inside, but is a map, not just an array. Or you need a hash set that will only take integers. There are several libraries that will give you this. For example, there's a one that I'm using right now is a Koloboke collections, which gives you hash sets, hash maps, and all sorts of other things that are that so-called unboxed, so they do not take up the extra 16 bytes of object per integer. Yeah?
One other question. I hear that a lot of people would like to store the data out of heap also.
Yeah.
So not just unboxed. Are these collection types unboxed and out of heap or inside heap?
These are unboxed inside heap. Yeah, so you need to find a different library that gives you off heap collections. Yeah. So but even just for on heap collections, you look at the ratio of sizes, it still is about four, five times difference in memory, which can save a lot of either money if this is EC2 instances, or it could save performance if you're finding yourself paging a disk, or it could save even time, because if your thing takes up so much less memory, you don't need to worry about memcache, database, whatever. You just hold it all in one big data structure in your process, and it doesn't take up too much space. So in this case, the top one is a Java util hash map, and the bottom one is the Koloboke special unboxed hash map, which only can take ints and ints in this case, but it takes up a lot less space. So after memory usage, the next thing that people often ignore is garbage collection. So garbage collection is easy to take for granted. Everyone says, oh, Java's a garbage collector language. Don't worry about where your objects are being stored. A garbage collector will take care of it. And in theory, it's invisible, but in practice, it can make your application perform very weirdly because it starts running at inopportune times and it makes your users wait while it's collecting its own garbage. So there are many garbage collectors that you can pick in Java, and that's something that many people don't know and something you don't learn early on, but it actually makes a huge difference. For example, the default garbage collector is called a parallel garbage collector. It is supposedly the fastest garbage collector because it stops the world and can collect everything in parallel and let everything start running again. But as a result, it has to stop the whole world relatively frequently, and that can be a problem because if someone clicks a button and suddenly your garbage collector starts running, that person will be waiting for it to finish garbage collecting before they get a response.
So if you check on multi-core system, it's quite usual that any stop the world parallel GC will not scale beyond certain number of cores.
Yeah.
So that's a bit misleading. So it's not really that parallel if you have enough.
Depends, for the correct value of enough, like for 2 or 4 cores, it's probably fine. If you have 32 or 64 cores, then that's totally different.
If you have a lot of cores, you will actually see that
at
some point it will just be only 1/3 used or 2 threads instead of all cores.
Yeah. But
and it still stops it.
Yeah.
So it will stop everything else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so what's interesting about the Stop the World Garbage Collector is that it is, at least as a simplification, it is a copying garbage collector. So it basically lets your program fill up with garbage and lets your memory space fill up with garbage. And once it's full, it will take the parts of the memory that you actually care about and copy only those parts to the new memory space and just ignore all the garbage. So this has a few interesting characteristics in that how long it takes to copy over the stuff to a new memory space and start running the code using the new memory space does not depend on how much garbage there is, because it only copies over the stuff that it is currently being actively used. So for example, the live set of data within your program, the stuff that hasn't been turned to garbage yet. The other interesting characteristic is that how long this garbage collection happens, how long it takes to perform this garbage collection when you copy over the live data to a new memory space, depends on how big your live data is. So if you have a huge amount of garbage and very little actual data, this process is really fast. And if you have not much garbage, but a lot of live data that you're keeping in memory, this process becomes very slow. And you can see that here. So there are many small garbage collections that happen, and these typically don't take up very long. But when it hits the real Stop the World garbage collection, this is a point where all of this was garbage and copied over the valid set of data, the live set of data, which is not garbage, that can still be used in your program, to a new memory space, not shown here, and all the garbage disappears. So we can actually see this ourselves. So over here, I have a small garbage collection benchmark. It's not a very good garbage collection benchmark, but it is a garbage collection benchmark. What it does is we create a bunch of, we basically have an array of random arrays that we use as a live set of data. So we fill up this base array with a bunch of object arrays of varying sizes. And exactly what we fill it up is not that important as long as you fill it up, at least as a first approximation. And then over here, I have a while loop that runs forever. I need to do this so the compiler doesn't complain that the stuff below is unreachable. And I need to put the stuff below so the compiler doesn't remove all the code as dead code. But inside this infinite while loop, I just create a bunch of garbage. So I every iteration of the outer loop, I loop for garbage rate times, and I stuff a bunch of newly created, which will be all completely empty, object arrays into the base array. And in doing so, that makes a base array, what was previously in that slot, garbage. And I just keep doing it. So I have a base array. I just keep putting in new stuff and putting in new stuff and putting in new stuff. And the old stuff will have to get garbage collected, and because that's the job of the garbage collector. So we can tweak the max object size. We can run this by passing in the working set size and the garbage rate from the command line. Let's use a default garbage collector. So if I java gc.java and then java setting the max heap to 1 gigabyte with 500,000 items in the default in the working set and a 200 items of garbage per millisecond. We can see that there's a big garbage collection, that some of the iterations are going to be really slow when there's a big garbage collection, and the other iterations are going to be moderately fast, either because there are no garbage collection or they're having a small garbage collection. And if you don't want to look at numbers, you can hook up a profiler. So for example, I like using JProfiler, but you can use JVisual VM, or you can use your kit or some other monitoring system. You can attach to JVM. I don't care about that. And you can see the memory going up and down, which is quite nice. So you can see this small collection, collects everything. And this is a step that takes 500 milliseconds. And then it crawls up again, collects everything. Another interesting property of the default garbage collector is that it will use all the memory you give it, no matter how much it actually needs. So in this case, the working set is about 200 megabytes, but I gave it 1 gigabyte of heap when I pass in at the command line over here with a x mx one gig. And so it's going to use 1 gigabyte. And the reason that is because the more heap you give it, the less frequently it has to perform these garbage collections. So as I mentioned before, how long this step takes in terms of time does not depend on how much garbage there is. But how frequently this step occurs depends on how big the heap is. Because if the heap was half as big, it would have to perform this garbage collection at this point, and at that point, and at that point. And each time it would still take the same amount of time, but it would have to happen much more frequently. And similarly, if the heap was much larger, it could go a lot further before it performs the garbage collection, but still take the same amount of time. And so, because in order to optimize the runtime, the Java virtual machine just waits until you fills up the whole memory you can give it, performs garbage collection, and does that over and over and over. And we can see that in that here it's taking about 400 milliseconds per garbage collection once in a while. And if I kill this and I give it like 500 megabytes of heat, let's let that run. You see now it should be taking, let's zoom in a bit. Now I can see it's more or less taking 400 milliseconds every time. And if I attach a profiler to see what's happening, you can see that it's approaching the limit and just garbage collecting each time it approaches the limit. But it still has the same pause time of 400 milliseconds. Conversely, if I give it the full 1 gigabyte of heat, I reduce the working set from 500,000 items to 300,000 items, we should see the pause times go down. So let's if you attach a profiler, you can see now it's still, once in a while, it still needs to perform a big garbage collection, but a big garbage collection takes about 250-300 milliseconds. And conversely, if I increase the size of the working set, the pause times will go up. So this is kind of an unintuitive behavior. Most people imagine if you create less garbage, your garbage collector will pause for short amounts of time, which is actually not accurate. So you create less garbage, your garbage collector will pause less often, but each pause will still be just as long. So if you have a really big heap, even if you create small amounts of garbage, maybe it'll only pause once every 2 or 3 minutes, but after 2 or 3 minutes, it's going to have a half second, 1 second pause, and people, your users may notice. So here I gave it a 700,000 item working set, and now it's pausing for 500, almost 600 milliseconds each time. And you can see it scales more or less linearly. So if we go back to the slides, I've plotted this out earlier, so you can see without having to wait so long. This is a on the left side, you have the number of items in the working set. Each item is an array from 0 to 200. Units long, full of nulls, so they don't actually have much complexity in the heap. It's just a bunch of arrays. It's just a bunch of arrays just sitting there doing nothing. And you have the garbage rate, like how much garbage am I creating every iteration of the loop? And you'll see that it doesn't really matter how much garbage you create. Your max pause times like only depend on how big your live set is. So it is a live set that determines how long a garbage collector pauses. It's how much data structures you're actually using that matters, and not how much garbage you're creating. So for a parallel garbage collector, what's things to remember? Pause time is proportional to the working set, or like what live data structures you have in your program, not to your garbage. And at least on my computer, and I think on the VMs I measured, typically is about 1 millisecond per megabyte of working set, so maybe plus minus order of factor of two or three. But if you have one gigabyte of live memory in your heap, you are going to be waiting 1 second each garbage collection probably, and 1 second is something that's actually quite noticeable. Like if you're using IntelliJ with large project and the beach ball starts spinning, that is when it's garbage collecting its large IDE heap.
Yeah, that depends whether you use heap objects.
Yeah, and so
or
this.
Or some things that do not contain pointers, because if they are not searched for pointers, you don't have a problem.
Yeah, so if you.
So you need gigabyte of live pointers.
Yeah, which is, IntelliJ uses a gigabyte sometimes, and that's all life. And Eclipse does. So next thing, frequency is proportional to garbage load, inversely proportional to total memory. So more memory will not make your garbage collections shorter. Creating less garbage will not make your garbage collections shorter either. They'll make them happen less often, but when they happen, they'll be the same length. So if the length is a problem, more memory or less garbage will not help. And it'll use up as much heap as it can, which is something that's somewhat unusual. Like most times you imagine, write a program, it'll allocate memory dynamically, but only allocate what it needs. But in the case of the parallel garbage collector, because of these two properties, the more memory you give it, the more memory it uses, the faster it runs, because it runs garbage collection less often. So if you give it 1 gigabyte, it'll use 1 gigabyte, even if it only needs 20, 50 megabytes of heat. It'll use the whole thing just to be faster. If you don't say what you're giving it, by default it uses 1/4 of the memory on your system. So if you don't pass in the X, MX, whatever gigabytes, on my computer it'll by default use 4 gigabytes of RAM. Even if it's some tiny program, it will still use up the 4 gigabytes of RAM just to optimize the garbage collection. So Java has a reputation of having a slow garbage collector, and in many ways it's fast, but it results in long pauses, at least by default. So the reputation is not entirely unjustified. If you just start running Java programs without any tweaking, you will find yourself with relatively large garbage collections that do take up noticeable amounts of time. But Java has multiple garbage collectors, and swapping the others is actually something that's very easy and is worth trying if these long pauses are problematic. This slide illustrates that less garbage doesn't affect pause times. You can create more and more garbage. The graph looks like that, to that, to that, to that. But in the end, each garbage collection still takes up the same amount of time. It just happens more often. So the next garbage collector that we'll touch on is a concurrent mark and sweep garbage collector. So the memory profile of this looks very different. First thing you may notice, you can't really see it, but this only goes up to 500 megabytes, and this hangs around 300 megabytes. So the concurrent mark and sweep garbage collector works differently from parallel. Rather than taking the live objects and copying them to a new space and just ignoring the rest, it goes and marks the various as a first approximation, simplified. It marks all the objects within your heap as live or not live, and collects the not live ones, collects the dead ones, and allows you to allocate new objects in the space of the dead ones were previously allocated in. So one property of this is the garbage collector now can depend on how long garbage collection takes can depend on how much garbage you have in your heap, not just on your live set. And waiting till you have more garbage does not speed up that process. So the parallel garbage collector, more garbage, it all takes the same amount of time to collect, so might as well wait until you have as much as possible. For the concurrent mark and sweep, more garbage will take longer to collect, so it just collects as it goes along because there's nothing to optimize. So this one does not take up as much heap as possible. This one kind of has a buffer, but if you give it 1 gigabyte and it only needs a few hundred meg, it will stick with a few hundred meg until the needs grow. In terms of the garbage collection pause times, you can see that for a lot of the smaller live sets, the pause times are much less. In that the concurrent mark and sweep is concurrent and doesn't wait until the garbage builds up to collect it all. And so as long as you're not generating more garbage than the thing can collect in the background, it generally will not pause for very long. It's on order like few tens of milliseconds per pause, which actually is reasonable. Like if you're making a game, you'll notice the frame rate stuttering a bit, but you won't have the whole thing freeze for half a second while it collects its trash. The other thing we notice is that once you start having a bigger, more garbage collection pressure, like a bigger heap, the amount of garbage you collect, you create, actually does matter. So if you look at the case where we have 800,000 items in our live set, then it actually matters whether we are creating a small amount of garbage or a medium amount of garbage or a large amount of garbage. In that, because the concurrent mark and seek garbage collector collects concurrently, as the name suggests, if you're creating less garbage and it can collect on its parallel, on its background thread, it's fine, doesn't take up much time. But if you're creating more garbage and it can collect on its background thread, at some point you're going to run out of memory because it just can't collect fast enough. And then it does, and then that's a case where it'll stop the world, stop you from running, stop you from creating more garbage, and collect everything back to base, the baseline. And that's why you see over here, it starts, when you create more garbage, it starts taking up more time. And we can see this when we run our benchmarks. So if we go to the code, to run the mark and sweep garbage collector, there's a flag. There's a flag dash x, let's see, dash xx use conk mark sweep gc. So let's go back to the original 500 items. Let's go back, JProfiler, it's attached to it, and let's see what it looks like. Yeah, so you can see that the memory is relatively stable at a few hundred megabytes. It keeps a buffer more than it needs, but doesn't grow unbounded like the parallel one does. And the garbage collections are all relatively small, and if you look at the timings, like on the order of tens of milliseconds, relatively fast. And if we increase the garbage collection load to this case with 800,000 items in the live set and 6400 items, items of garbage per iteration, 6400 items. Let's connect to there and see what it looks like. So, so now we can see that the garbage collection has started taking longer than previously did, and it's also started taking up more memory, and this is after remaining flat, basically flat for all the earlier times. And that's because it's starting to actually have to stop the main process in order to garbage collect. And once you get into large heap sizes, it has to stop the main process very, very often, and everything takes forever. And that's unavoidable. So the concurrent mark and sweep garbage collector is not the default, but it's an alternative to a parallel GC. You can turn it on with a simple flag. There's less throughput in parallel GC, so if you have like a huge batch job, you don't care about pauses, you just want to finish as fast as possible, the parallel GC does, the default garbage collector runs faster. But the pause times are much less. So if you're running something that you don't want to pause for half a second or 1 second when it's a big heap, this actually is quite useful. And it also does not grow the heap unnecessarily, which is useful if you're running some kind of command line application in Java and you don't know how much memory it will take because it depends on what the user does with it, like whether it loads a small file or a huge file, don't know how much memory it will take. If you use a parallel GC, it will always take up all the memory. Whereas if you use a concurrent mark and sweep, it will use up more or less a bit more memory than it needs, but a proportional amount. Yeah, and the maximum pause times are generally relatively low. So the last garbage collector we'll look at is the G1 garbage first garbage collector. So this is a relatively new GC. Relatively new means like less than 20 years old. And it's probably going to be the default in the next version of Java 9. And it's basically somewhat like a hybrid between the concurrent mark and sweep and the parallel garbage collector. In terms of performance characteristics, it is kind of similar to both. It performs faster than the mark and sweep for small amounts, and performs about the same as a parallel one for large heaps. And there's not that much to say about it except that it's generally a pretty nice generally a pretty nice garbage collector. It has a more or less a nice parts of both the concurrent marker and sweep and the parallel. So, for example, if you have a relatively small program, having it pause for 30 seconds garbage collecting is much more reasonable than having it pause for 300 milliseconds in the case of the parallel garbage collector. So you just actually compare what it's like. So as I mentioned, the parallel gets really fast if your working set is really small. Even if you're creating lots of garbage, the concurrent mark and sweep takes about the same amount of time. Even if your working set is small, it still takes the same amount of time. As it gets larger, it takes the same amount of time. And the G1 gets you really fast. It's really fast when the working set's small, and also doesn't scale up so ferociously as the working set gets larger. So while the parallel GC may take a third of a second to pause your program to garbage collect, in this case, the new G1 GC takes 40 milliseconds, which is much less. Okay, so that's the high level of what these garbage collectors are like. Another interesting point of note is that most garbage collectors nowadays are generational. So the generational hypothesis, as they call it, says that most objects in your program are either very long-lived or very short-lived. So for example, the things you allocate within the method tend to get thrown away before the method returns. Whereas things that allocate in like big global data structures tend to live forever, and there's no point checking them where they need to be collected. And whether or not that's true, people think it's true, and garbage collectors will optimize for those cases to make them really fast. So if your code has either really long-lived or really short-lived objects and no medium-lived objects, the garbage collection gets much happier. So for example, if I go back to the garbage collection benchmark we had just now, and I'm going to run this with the default garbage collector, so no XX flags. But instead of writing my new objects all over the array of live objects, I'm going to write my new objects only in the first 200 elements of that array. So for example, if I have 500,000 elements in my set of random objects, the first 200 will be written and overwritten, overwritten, over and over, and get thrown away quickly, while the next almost 500,000 will just sit there and live forever. So this will be a profile that matches the so-called generational hypothesis, where things live for really short or live really long. And if we run this code with the same 500,000, 200 that we were originally using, let's attach a profiler to it so you can see what's happening. Profiler. You can see that the garbage collections take really short now. So this is same number of objects in the live set, same number of objects created per iteration of our loop. So still 200 objects per iteration, 500,000 objects in our live set. But because our workload is generational and most of the objects in the live set live forever, and a few get thrown away really quickly, the garbage collector is much, much happier. And in this case, you can see it takes almost no time, despite having the same amount of garbage and same live set. Trying to connect Wi-Fi down, okay, whatever. So concretely, if you want to learn more about this, the garbage collector, at least the default one, has multiple spaces, and it garbage collects the first one the most, the second one less, and the third one hardly at all. And it's also an order of increasing time it takes to perform these garbage collections. So if you allocate the object and it gets collected in the next garbage collection, then it's gone. If it survives, it gets moved from this space to the survivor space. And if it survives again, it gets moved into tenured. And if all your if all the garbage dies in Eden, your garbage collections will get much shorter and much faster. And you can read more if you want. There's a lot of material about this fact online. So I've already showed a demo. Yeah, so if it's generational and if it's non-generational, it has a really different memory profile. Okay, so takeaways, the default garbage collector will take up all your memory, give it, and it will result in pauses if you have a large working set, and doesn't matter how much memory you give it or how little garbage you create. But you can try, if you want to, you can swap out the garbage collector and have generally have much shorter pauses and have much better not taking up all my memory behavior. So now we're done with garbage collection, the next thing I'll cover is compilation. So we all know probably that Java compiles to bytecode and that JVM will just-in-time compile it to assembly at runtime. But what does that actually mean? If you look at a method like this, for example, this is from our garbage collection demo earlier. This is an init method, static, void, calls a few methods, does a subtraction, assigns it to some variable. This gets compiled into bytecode that looks like this, where you invoke a static method, you invoke total memory, you invoke get runtime again, you invoke free memory. The Java bytecode runs on a stack, so after you invoke total memory, the total memory is just the last item on the stack, and then the free memory just gets put on top of it. I mean, you call sub, it subtracts the top two items on the stack and puts in the result in its place. So that's why you don't see any variable assignments in the bytecode. These things just put the variables on this stack, and this just subtracts it, and this just takes it off and puts it in the field on the heap, and then it returns from the function. So we can see this. So if I kill my garbage collection process and run Java p-c gc, so Java p prints out metadata about the Java class files, and if you put in -c, well, let's run it without -c first. So it says like I have this class gc with these methods, and if I put in -c, you get all the bytecode of what is being executed when you run this method, when you run this class. So for example, if I go to my memory, if I -c my memory class, you can see that over here is the init method with the bytecode compiled inside. So why is this useful? Why should you care about bytecode when you are writing Java? So this is useful because you can see what is so-called actually being run when you run your code. For example, if let's say input is an integer in this case, for simplicity, I didn't put the type declaration. But these two snippets of code, in theory, do the same thing. And if I look at my example, here, I have a random integer. One is added, one is valued off. I print out both of them. If I Java C stringify.java and Java stringify, you'll see that they both print out the same thing, which is the stringified version of the integer. Not that interesting, I suppose. But if I Java p it with -c, so I can see the bytecode, you can see that they actually behave pretty differently. So in the bottom case, it's a single method call to invoke static. So it calls invoke static of the method java lang string value of which takes the integer returns a string, and then that's it. In the quote plus input case, it gets compiled into this, which is a whole creates a string builder, calls init on the string builder, it calls append to append the empty quotes to the string builder. It then calls append to append integer to the string builder, and then it calls toString to give you your string. So So this is why it's sometimes useful to understand what the bytecode is like, because although these two snippets of code look about the same and behave about the same in most cases, maybe sometimes you're wondering why is there garbage being collected when I create so much garbage being created when I do this, or you're wondering why is the performance of this slower than that. And when you look into a bytecode, you'll see that they actually have pretty different implementations under the cover in the bytecode. Similarly, if you look at switches, an int switch looks like that in the bytecode. So there's a lookup switch instruction that says if it's 0, jump to 40, if it's 1, jump to 48, and otherwise jump to 53. So it comes here, it jumps either here, here or here, and then that's very fast. A string switch, on the other hand, looks very different from an integer switch, even though in the code it looks about the same and semantically behaves the same. So a string switch, you can see whether the string is 0 or the string is 1. But unlike the integer switch, there's no simple like jump on string bytecode. And so what happens is, first it calls, let's go to the next slide where it's bigger. First it calls hash code on the string, then it does a switch on the hash code of the string, and then so it goes to 104, which is here, or 119, which is down here. And after it jumps there, it then loads the string and compares calls dot equals on the two strings. And if it's equal, it then will go and do something. And similarly, on the other case, if it's equal, it'll go and do something. So this is something that you can't really see in the code, but it becomes obvious when you look at the bytecode that string switches are basically just if-else statements with a hash code in front, and have the same property as if-else statements with a hash code in front, in that they take linear time depending how long they are instead of constant time to jump to the correct offset. Okay, so why read bytecode? It helps you understand what your Java code compiles to. If you care about memory usage, if you care about performance characteristics, if you really need to speed that thing up and you're not sure how, this helps. If you are debugging frameworks and muck with bytecode, if you're using AspectJ or JavaSyst, one of those many other frameworks that will add magic things to your bytecode to turn your method asynchronous or turn your bean into a database accessor object, then knowing what the bytecode is like helps you when things go wrong. And if you're working with non-Java JVM languages, Scala, Clojure, Groovy, whatever, JRuby, the lowest common denominator when all of these interact with Java is the Java bytecode. None of these languages generate Java source code. They all generate Java bytecode, and that's how they actually talk to your program. Okay, the last thing I'm going to touch on is looking at the assembly. So we've talked about compilation from Java to bytecode. There's also the JIT compilation from bytecode to assembly, which often you don't look at, but you can, and it's not as much of a black box as people tend to think. So this takes a bit of setup. So you need to install some DLL or shared object file in the correct place for it to work. But once you've done so, you can see things like this. This Java source code ends up corresponding to this assembly instructions. These three assembly instructions, with a move, a decrement, and a jump not equals to go back to here if it's not done, and looping quickly in that order. So when I said bytecode is what's actually being run, that's not quite true. It's what's being run one level down, but below the bytecode, yeah, what's actually being run, which is the assembly. And this is a thing that's fed into your Intel or AMD CPU and then gets executed. So if we look at to do that, can take a look at this demo. So here is a small class that does total equals 1. It keeps multiplying total with the current loop variable, and then it prints out total at the end. So how do I do this? It's Java C JIT.java and Java JIT. So this prints out 0 because I start from 0. Gets multiplied by 0 if total equals total times i. Yes, let me see what's happening here. I equals one, try along. 1 second, let me see why this is misbehaving. Total equals total times I. First 100 iterations. Okay, so it works, it just caps out and ends up being zero at some point. So, we run this and maybe we think this does what we expect it to, but if we want to look at the assembly, we can. So let me go and pull up the assembly instructions. No internet. Okay.
The position of Wi-Fi is not
working. Yep, I have noticed. So, let's see if I have it in my command line history. Come on. Okay, well, I guess I have to pull it up on my phone. What? 4 minutes left. Okay.
Almost three.
Print assembly. If not, I guess I'll just skip this. Okay, so I guess I probably won't have time to show in demo in detail. But one interesting example of looking through the assembly is if you have polymorphic code like this. So for example, if I interface hello with get and hello one, hello two, and I have a loop that does this, then one question that we may ask is, how does it matter how many subclasses of hello are in there? If you look at the bytecode, if you measure it before you look at the bytecode, because that's often easier, if you measure it, you'll see that, yes, it does matter how many subclasses of hello there are in this array. If there's one subclass, it takes 1.6 seconds. If there's two subclasses, it takes 2.2 seconds for however many iterations. And for three or more subclasses, it takes about 4.5 seconds. So you make me wonder, why is that the case? And if we look at the bytecode, we'll see that no matter how many subclasses there are, this hello.get is the same invoke interface call. So the bytecode doesn't change depending on how many subclasses there are. So that can't be the problem. But what actually, when you look at the assembly that is being generated from this bytecode, you can see that when there are two subclasses, this invoke interface of get method, when I call the get method on that, I don't know what this is, on this hello interface, it ends up being inline in that it checks whether it is a hello one, and jumps to somewhere to run some code, or whether it's a hello two and jumps to somewhere else to run some other code. So this is what happens. This is the assembly gets generated when there are two subclasses. When there are three subclasses, don't know where the slide went. So when there are three subclasses, this does not get inlined, and all you end up seeing is invoke assembly call queue instruction. So let's see if I can pull that up. Come on. Okay. Java C, jet, polymorphism. Java polymorphism dot Java and Java C dash XX colon plus unlock diagnostic VM options. Dash XX colon plus print assembly polymorphism. invalid flag, unlock diagnostic, tick VM options. Okay, that's not it. I can't spell. Dash XX, unlock diagnostic. Command plus, unlock diagnostic, VM options. There we go. I see the problem. This is a Java call, not Java C. Okay, so here we can see all the assembly being splattered out. I'm going to splatter out to a file, output.txt. And now if we look at output.txt, where is my output.txt? Here it is. I want to look for line 49. It generates thousands of lines of assembly, so this is not something you want to do too often. You'll see that in the case of having three, if you have three hello one, hello two, hello three in the arrays, you end up left with a single call queue instruction, which is a virtual method call in the Intel x86 assembly. Let me zoom in just so you can see it. You end up with that. So that's a difference between having two subclasses where you end up where it inlines the code for you, and having three subclasses or more where it doesn't inline the code, and it's up to the Intel processor to do the dispatch, and that's why you end up with this behavior where it's much faster if you have less than three subclasses in your polymorphism. Okay, so compiler takeaways. So dumb code runs faster, even if it looks the same in Java or it compiles the same bytecode. If your code looks more like C, it runs faster than if your code does not look more like C, even though you're writing Java. So if you're switching on integers, it's faster than switching on strings. If you don't use much polymorphism, it's faster than using lots of polymorphism, even if it's the exact same bytecodes that are being run.
You're saying write C.
Well, if you want to eke out the last bit, then sure. So that's this presentation, Taming the JVM. We've covered memory layouts, garbage collection, and compilation. All this is stuff that you don't normally think about when you're writing Java code at Java level, but actually can make quite a big impact when you're actually running your program. Like if your program is stopping for half a second every 5 seconds, these are the things that you want to tweak in order to make it behave better. So that's all the presentation. And to plug my product again, if you go to fluentcode.com, if you want a nice online code browser, we can't go now because the internet's down. But yeah, okay. Yes.
Cool. We don't really have time for questions.
Okay.
We're already 7 minutes over.
Sure.
Sorry.
Okay.
No questions?
Yeah,
you can
ask me out. I'll be around.
Cool.